on now?
We're good to go.
Hi, I'm Gail Eichenthal, and it is a great pleasure to be here on the final day of the Ojai Music Festival. I'm executive producer and host at Classical KUSC and KDB Santa Barbara, and the day started early for a lot of diehard Ojai Music Festival denizens. About a dozen people slept overnight on the floor on sleeping bags in the nearby Ojai Art Center, just down the road, for a musical happening. The music of Morton Feldman, a 4.5-hour, very gentle, pointillistic chamber work called for Philip Guston, a memorial homage to his former friend, the great American artist Philip Guston. Among those who slept overnight, my own beloved colleague, KUSC's Alan Chapman. Yes, Alan Chapman and his son, vibes player Jake Chapman, said it was an absolutely transcendental experience. The music gently started wafting through the room at a few minutes after 5 this morning. It was still dark. People sort of dozed in and out of the music, and by 5:30, about 70 people in line to attend this great musical happening. So just another day at the Ojai Music Festival. This concert we're about to hear this morning features prominently two brilliant virtuosos who personify a trend in global music, the sort of cross genres, cross cultural pollinization that we've been seeing throughout the festival, but particularly on this concert. Composers from all over the world, strongly influenced by jazz and even rock and folk. We're going to hear cellist Maya Beiser, Israeli-born, French father, Argentinian mother, who merges so many genres. Yesterday played pretty much a rock concert, sort of a la classical, uncovers, as she calls them, based on her best-selling album. And we'll also be very delighted to see once again the Pipa master Wu Man, who performed Lou Harrison's concerto at last night's concert. You can catch it on the stream anytime you want. Absolutely breathtaking performance of music of Lou Harrison, written for Wu Man. So they'll come together in duets and also solo works. And we're going to begin with music of MOHAMMED FAIROUZ. And just as a kind of emblem of the coming together of cultures, the work is called Kol Nidrei, the Hebrew Atonement Prayer. And of course, FAIROUZ, an Arab-American composer. This is music written for our soloist, Maya Beiser, and it is an electrified Kol Nidrei, an electrified cello. Then comes another solo cello piece by Cambodian composer CHINARY, Khse, Buon, in which the cello sort of channels an ancient South Asian instrument called the sarangi. Music for solo pipa by Wu Man herself will be next. And she is improvising largely in a piece called Dance of the Yi People. She did some improv last night after the concerto as an amazing encore, which I highly recommend to you on the stream. And here in a piece called Leaves Flying in Autumn, she takes the traditional martial style of pipa playing and incorporates a little bit of rock, American rock. Then Maya and Wu Man come together for Bright Sheng's Songs for Cello and Pipa, originally written for Yo-Yo Ma, and his Silk Road colleague, Wu Man, commissioned by the White House. Highlights after intermission include Chinese-born Tan Dun music, music also by Evan Ziporyn, who is American-born, studied at Yale, studied at Berkeley with Joseph Schwantner, then went to Bali and learned the gamelan. So a lot of his music is written for gamelan. An amazing clarinetist who's on the faculty at MIT. And we'll hear his work inspired by Sanskrit, ancient Sanskrit writings, featuring also one of the world's great tabla players. So that's after intermission. During intermission, a very special treat. We're going to present highlights of Steve Schick, artistic director of the Ojai Festival's Ojai U, a series of truly fascinating and engaging little workshops on percussion, on a percussionist's view of the world, and I know you'll enjoy it. And you can catch all of those little seminars, little sort of mini percussion 101 lessons at ojiu.org. I want to also mention that the Ojai Festival has forged a new relationship with a very forward-looking web stream Q2, which is the contemporary arm of WQXR in New York, so you can catch a lot of former Ojai Festival performances there on the web at WQXR's Q2. So there's a lot to be seen, a lot to be heard, and I know you'll enjoy this morning's Sunday program. It's always kind of a magical atmosphere as the sun comes out in beautiful Libby Park. And again, the diehards got up well before dawn, so it's going to be an all-day spectacular. Enjoy with me.
Everybody, I wanted to tell you a little bit about the piece that I'm going to open with. I grew up in a small little village in a valley overlooking the Jordan River, surrounded by the beautiful mountains of the Galilee in Israel, and it's not very different than this beautiful valley here of Ojai. It was a kibbutz, a Jewish community of immigrants from Argentina who wanted to try to create a better place for Jews to live, and we're also hoping to change the world and make it a better place. It's still a question whether it was succeeded, but we were surrounded by villages of Muslim Arabic Bedouins. And as a little girl, I would wake up every morning in the sunrise at 5 a.m. hearing the sounds of the muezzin, the call to prayer at the nearby mosque. And it became part of my musical landscape, though I was practicing Bach and Dvořák. But that those sounds just always stayed with me. My father was very close friends with a lot of the Bedouins in that village, and I've always wanted to find a way to bring that music to my cello. So in the past few years, I've commissioned several works for the cello in different Arabic tradition. But today, I want to play for you the iconic Kol Nidrei, which is the most known prayer in the Hebrew tradition. And as I was working on this project, I met this wonderful young composer in New York. He's a Muslim Palestinian. His name is MOHAMMED FAIROUZ. And when he heard that I was working on a Kol Nidrei project, he suggested to write a Kol Nidrei for me. So this is what you're going to hear today.
Hello. FAIROUZ. Thank you. One of the biggest problems that composers and maybe percussionists also have faced is how transferable is this music? When Mozart wrote a piano sonata, he had a reasonable expectation that it would sound somehow similar when it was played on a piano in Vienna, and it would be something the same if it were played in Paris, and in fact it's probably not that far from the original even if it's played on a modern piano in a concert hall. But when you write for medium gong, for example, and you then realize that there are probably 70 different types of medium gongs coming from different cultures, played with different mallets, having different cultural and religious backgrounds, your expectation of what medium gong sounds like can never be as specific as what Mozart's expectation for what piano would sound like. So, is this a liability? Does a composer then regret the fact that when she writes for break drum or bottle or flower pot, that she has no idea what size of break drum, what shape of bottle, or what texture of flower pot she will get? Well, if in fact your goal as a composer is to create a document which is ultimately transferable and produces the same result from player to player and from hall to hall and from context to context, then maybe percussion is not for you. What you will get, in fact, are these vital and lively differences, a language which is constantly being translated from one practitioner to the next, from one context to the next, So that when I hear, as I walk down the hallway of UC San Diego's music building here, I hear two people playing the same piece and using slightly or sometimes even radically different instruments, I can tell it's the same piece, but I can also hear them. I can hear the choices, the will, the volition of the individual as reflected in the choices that they made. You know, this led originally to a lot of composers writing for pieces for free instrumental choice. In fact, I think by the time you get to 1990, in other words, the first 30 years of percussion solo music, nearly all of the pieces, or some 80% thereabouts of the pieces, were written for some variation on freely chosen instrumentation. Now, sometimes that freely chosen instrumentation had certain guidelines for what kind of materials, whether they should be made of wood or skin, whether the instruments should be large or small, but performer choice of instruments was hugely important in the ultimate realization of those pieces. As instruments have become standardized, as practices have become more widespread, composers have relied less and less on those freely chosen models because, of course, now extant models exist. But still, at the root of percussion is the insertion of the performer at a very basic level of sound, identification, and cultivation. So that my version of Yannis Xenakis' Safa, with the instruments that I have chosen according to Xenakis' guidelines, is really quite different from Gert Mortensen, the great Danish percussionist's version of the same piece. It will be very different from what a student of mine will do. And so instead of fearing this ambivalence in the world of percussion, percussionists and percussion lovers and composers who have written for the instrument have sought to embrace it. Percussion is very much like an oral tradition. The fact is that those early pieces, they offered freedom of choice of instrumentation. But then when a piece has been learned and championed by a percussionist, perhaps recorded and then studied subsequently in schools and academies, a kind of oral tradition takes place where gradually the choices focus, almost as though the community has decided this is the way we'll play a certain kind of piece. Naturally, there continue to be outliers, but a focused language starts to develop. It's always the question of what to do with a new experience, right? How do you listen to a piece of music you've never heard before? Perhaps in a medium like percussion that you're unfamiliar with, that feels a little scary, that feels a little unusual. And I mean, I went sort of through boot camp with that. I mean, I come from a family of farmers. My mother was a pretty good amateur pianist, but she never pursued it. She became a farm wife and the mother of five children. So I would hear her play Chopin late at night, and it would mix with the sounds of the wind, you know, across the farmlands in this fantastic way until, you know, for years I only associated Chopin with winter and with howling winds, because that's the only time I ever heard it. But when I started playing percussion, and especially when I started playing contemporary percussion, I was playing for my family, who really didn't have the faintest idea how to understand it. I mean, and there were both fantastic and painful memories of my dad leaving Clear Lake in planting season to come to the University of Iowa, where I was doing a master's recital, and sitting through back-to-back performances of Quintakta because we thought the Stockhausen masterpiece, at 35 minutes long for piano, percussion, and electronic tape, was just simply insufficient if you played it just once. And I mean, what he made of all of that, I have no idea. But our conversations were absolutely fascinating. And here was a man who didn't have a musical background, didn't come with, armed with standards about classical music, or didn't understand the contribution of the Vienna Philharmonic to modern cultural thought, didn't think about that at all. But he was a person who understood what it meant to build something. He was a person who understood what it meant to take a stand. He was a person who understood what it meant to take a risk and go off by yourself and say, if this works, it's great, but if it doesn't, we're basically sunk, because that's the life story of a farmer. And so this is what I grew up around, and early on I realized that the way to fail was to be dishonest, whether as a performer or as a listener. So playing for my family taught me that the only way forward was to dive in completely. And when I was a young professional, I signed on with this company, an agency from New York, I don't think it exists anymore, called Affiliate Artists, and they put musicians, performers in unconventional performing sites. And so I spent 6 weeks in my first tour with them, 6 weeks in central Washington, in and around Wenatchee, Washington, playing Stockhausen Zyklus. I played Stockhausen Zyklus 125 times in central Washington, in packing plants and libraries and mental health institutions and old folks' homes, and at a construction site where I literally thought they were going to kill me because of, I mean, I came a little late, I'll grant you, and they were finished and they were well into their keg of beer. And so when I started in on the great modernist masterpiece, Stockhausen Zyklus, there was a sort of grumbling amongst the workers that told me that perhaps I'd gone one step too far. I mean, that's that crazy thing where you realize that the line you're trying to not to cross is just a couple of feet behind you. And so I stopped playing and I passed out the instruments and we had a jam session for 45 minutes. That was a much better plan. So as I have tried to figure out how to present unusual music in such a way that is honest and friendly to the listener, my only real advice to people who are trying to understand unusual music is to think of it as a kind of conversation. A conversation between people who want to be friends. And from my side, I think that the most honorable thing I can do to a listener is to take him or her seriously. So whenever I have a chance to play in front of people, I play the music that moves me, whether it's the most difficult to understand or the easiest to understand. And I think it's a disservice to a listener to do something, to do anything other than that. So when I have the great privilege and thrill of playing a solo concert at Ojai, I'm going to give you the things that have moved me over the course of the last 40 years. And some of them will be prickly, but if you get close enough, you can befriend even a porcupine.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.